And there you are, Steve.
Yeah, hi. Hi, everybody. Hi, Joan. Hi, Bill. I saw you too, Frank.
Martin, I'm going to give you a little introduction of the colorful past and history of Martin. Martin is a wonderful, history of his life. He was born in South Africa, and when he was very young, probably at college student age, he went to Israel. He made aliyah when he was very young. He studied agriculture at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. And he married before I was born. He married in 1958 and lived in Rehovot. And he moved to Jerusalem in 1965 to study microbiology at Hebrew University. So the Hadassah Medical School. And he graduated with a PhD in microbiology in 1969. And about 30 years later, during which time he fought many wars on behalf of Israel. But in 1997, he moved to the United States to join the NIH, the National Cancer Institute of the National Institutes of Health. And he was a member of Tiferet Israel, and he became the first hero of Calivia, according to her. Now he's retired. He lives in New Hampshire. His daughter and two sons from his first marriage live with their families in Israel. And one of his daughters was on a rescue flight evacuating Ethiopian Jews from Sudan. Correct me, Martin, was it 1984? Was it Operation Solomon or Operation Moses?
Solomon,
Operation Solomon. So take it away, Martin.
Okay. Well, good evening, everybody. And thank you very much to Frank and the congregation for inviting me to give this talk. I'm coming to you, as Frank mentioned, from Northern New Hampshire. We're in the White Mountains. And I belong to a small community up here called the Bethlehem Hebrew Congregation. We live in a town called Bethlehem, which is quite appropriate. And in fact, this year we are celebrating our 100th anniversary. So unfortunately COVID put a dent in that, but the 100th year is the 100th year. So let me begin by sharing my screen. And I'm gonna tell you a story about how I came to visit the Kotel, or came to be at the Kotel on the very first day it was open to the public. And the day was Shavuot, 1967. It was just after the Six-Day War. But I want to preface this with a few remarks. Let's just take a quick look at a few distinct dates in the history of Jerusalem. Destruction of the First Temple, destruction of the Second Temple, and for about 400 years, Jerusalem was ruled by the Turks. The Ottoman Emperor Suleiman, it was he who actually built the walls around Jerusalem. 1914, First World War. 1918, as a result of the Balfour Declaration, the British Mandate of Palestine begins. Of course, 39 to 45 was the Second World War, Holocaust of 6 million Jews. And in 1947, was the end of the British Mandate. And we all know the story that Israel was attacked by several Arab countries in the surrounding area. And in 1948, they fought the War of Independence, which was an amazingly brave war to fight at that time. Very heavy casualty. But as a result of that, Jerusalem was divided between Israel and Jordan. And from 1948, we had no access to the old city of Jerusalem that remained in Jordanian hands. 1967 was the Six-Day War. And as a result of the Six-Day War, Jerusalem was reunited as one city. And of course, we once again had access to the Kotel as we had before. But let me tell you a little story that prior to this, to what I'm going to tell you. Basically, I'm going to tell you how I came to be involved in the Six-Day War. I was not in Jerusalem. I was down in the Sinai Desert, as you will see. But prior to that, this whole story began on Yom Ha'atzma'ut, 1967, the 6th of May, 1967. And there was a tradition in Israel at that time that on every Yom Ha'atzma'ut, we held a festival hazemer, a song festival, at the Binyanei Umar, at the big convention center in Jerusalem. And my wife and I would go every year. And we did that year as well. But at the end of the festival, there was a special song that had nothing to do with the actual competition. It was actually a competition, the Festival HaZemer. And we heard for the very first time, Shuli Natan, who was only 20 years old at the time, singing for the very first time in public, Yerushalayim Shel Zahav, Jerusalem of Gold. So let's hear a few bars from that song.
Avir harim tzalul kayayin Vireak oranim Nisa beruach arbaim Im kol pamodim Uvetardimat ilan vaeven Shvuya bachaloma Ha'ir asher badan yoshevet Uveliva Yerushalayim shel zahav veshel nechoshet veshel or Anu lechol shirayich ani kinor Yerushalayim shel zahav veshel nechoshet veshel or Anu lechol shirayich ani
And this is actually a depiction of the Jerusalem gold as painted by our current shlicha to the Jewish Federation of New Hampshire, really a lovely young woman, Avia Sagron. But the morning after the song festival is when the story really begins. I think you will agree with me that it was really amazing to hear that first performance by Shuli Natan of the song written by Nomi Shemer. But the morning after the song festival, around 8 a.m., I was called up to reserve duty, miluim in Hebrew, by an officer knocking on my apartment door in Beit HaKerem in Jerusalem. And he told me, he said, this is serious. So there were hurried goodbyes to my wife and my two children, and off to our base just south of Rehovot to outfit our unit. But for a moment, let's go back to February 1967, when my unit held its inaugural training exercise in the freezing cold northern Negev near Beersheba. And we were a company of armored infantry soldiers in support of a battalion of British Centurion tanks. Our combat transport vehicles were half tracks from United States Army World War II surplus. And here is the half track. And you can see, you can see my cursor. This is actually me sitting on the half track. And this was our officer and other people, other friends. So this was the vehicle that took us into the Sinai Desert when the Six-Day War broke out. But in point of fact, what happened is NASA had blockaded the Straits of Tiran, not allowing ships, preventing Israeli ships from both arriving or leaving Eilat. And this in fact was a casus belli. This was the reason, one of the main reasons that the Six-Day War was going to take place. But what happened to us, in order to try to prevent the war from happening, let diplomacy try to see what they could do, we were deployed for 3 weeks, waiting near Beersheba in a field of thorns. I can still remember them so well, and to this day, until the war began on Monday, the June the 5th, when we received our orders to cross into Egypt. And during this time, I began to write a diary written in tiny handwriting in a pocket diary from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, which I happened to have with me. I was at that time, as Frank mentioned earlier, a graduate student in microbiology at the Hebrew University Hadassah Medical School in Jerusalem. And 50 years later, my son Iran and my granddaughter Liron decided to publish the diary, which I will show you at the end of the show this evening. Here is a picture of the diary. I'll show you the actual diary when we finish the presentation. As you can see, it's a Yoman, 1966-67. And what I used it for was to write in this terrible scrawl that you see, my impressions of what was happening around me, right from the time that we sat in that location for 3 weeks, through the fighting in Sinai, and coming back at the end of the war. And what we did, what my son and my granddaughter did, was we transcribed. It's very difficult to read any of these pages. We transcribed all of the writing into something that could be written, and it's presented in the diary, in the printed diary. You have the page that's written in my handwriting opposite the page in actual readable English. So if we just take this one little paragraph here, I'll read it with you. It says here, the forces are nevertheless, and let's see it here. The forces are nevertheless drawn, and we simply await the outcome of the diplomatic activity, which doesn't, on the surface, appear to be able to bear concrete results. Thus, to sum up the nationalistic aspect, this country has no right to exist under present circumstances. The fight will be hard, but a loss will be the end of the Third Commonwealth. So it will be a fight to the death. This means that people will die next to you and around you, people you've got to know well in the last 10 days, some husbands, fathers, with all the implications of personal tragedy. But it all seems unreal, as if it could never happen. Here you are in a paradise. How can the horrors of war lie only a few hours' journey away or just over the hill? All is set for the final order, and silence just hangs in the air. And you are suspended between the world and so on and so forth. And this is the actual printed copy of the diary, which I'll show you also at the end of the presentation. And that happens to be me in my basic training many, many, many years ago. So let's see what the situation was. This is Israel before the 67 war. And you can see that the borders are fairly tight. You have Judea and Samaria up here, Samaria, Judea. And take note of Beersheba, which is a central location. And as I said, we were sitting just very close to Beersheba for the 3 weeks before the war actually broke out. And when the war broke out, we crossed into the Sinai Desert, here in the northern part of the Sinai Desert, and made our way to the Suez Canal. Being an infantry group around our tanks, the tanks actually did the fighting, and we were fortunately not called upon to do anything really serious. So it was basically just chasing and providing support to the tanks in terms of bringing them water and food and things like that. So what was the situation after this? So this is actually what happened. This is here's Jerusalem up here. And what I'm showing you is an actual map that I had in my possession during the actual war. And I would scribble on the map. These are the names of people in my group that actually signed the map at the end. But our purpose was, as I said, we were in Beersheba. We stayed around Beersheba for 3 weeks. And then if you follow this red line is where we crossed. Over here is the border, as you can see on the right, on the left, on the right-hand side. This is the border between us. Sorry about that. And our purpose was to follow the red line and to get actually to the Suez Canal. The purpose was not to capture the Suez Canal at this time. That happened in the 1973 war when we crossed over to the other side of the canal. But basically we were here and we prevented any of the Egyptians from crossing the canal. And as a result of that, the whole of the Sinai Peninsula fell into Israeli hands. And that was basically at the end of the war. And so this is, you can see it here in a little bit of higher detail. Following over to here, and just at this point over here, some of you may have heard of the Mittler Pass, which was one of the passes that one had to go through. And we made our way to a place called Port Taufik. And this is Suez again, seen it at a much higher magnification. And so that was basically what we did. We raced down to here. We got here in about 2 days. As I said, there was fighting, but we were actually behind most of the serious fighting, so it didn't affect us particularly. And then all the way back, we stayed there for about 2 days, turned around, and came all the way back. And back to the story of Jerusalem, which was liberated by the IDF paratroopers on Wednesday, June the 7th. Remember, the war started on Monday, June the 5th. And for us, after a nonstop two-day drive back to Israel from the Suez Canal, I was demobbed from the army on Tuesday, June the 13th. And my family visited the Kotel that very next day, Shavuot, Wednesday, June the 14th, the first day the Kotel was open to the public. And you'll see what had to be done in order for the Kotel to be open to the public. Okay. This is a general map of Jerusalem. And I just want to point you particularly to some of the things that you would probably know. The Knesset is over here. Those of you that have been to Jerusalem would certainly know that. This is an area, Beta Kerem is where I lived at the time. And here we see the old city. It's four quarters, the Jewish quarter, Armenian quarter, Christian quarter, and the Muslim quarter. And basically this, as I said, was now back in our hands. And what we're going to do is drive as close as possible to the old city and then walk into the old city by a specially designated route. But let's take a quick look at the Kotel as it was before 1948.
I love
what it was this very, very narrow street. And as you can see, many people are here praying. So it was accessible, but was just this very, very narrow street. And you'll see what happened to the Kotel as a result of the Six-Day War. But just briefly, the battle for Jerusalem, as you can see, on June the 5th, the Israelis went over into Jordan and fought quite heavy battles. Some of you may remember the Ammunition Hill battle. This up here, Augusta Victoria, and right next to it should be Mount Scopus with the Hebrew University that actually remained as an enclave of Israeli territory, but we couldn't get there on a normal basis. We just held it and had soldiers at that there for the 20 years between 48 and 67, 19 years. And so what happened was that the Israelis took the high ground, and from this high ground, they then, on June the 7th, the yellow arrows that you can see here, broke into the old city through the Lion Gate and conquered the old city, basically. But once they had the advantage of being on the ridge, where Augusta Victoria and Hadassah Hospital are, they had the advantage, and the Jordanians really had no option but to either leave or surrender. And this is the iconic picture of the paratroopers that took the the old city on that 7th of June. And here's a picture of the same three people 50 years later. Karasenti, this guy on the left, is a choreographer. Yitzhak Yifat is actually a gynecologist. And Chaim Oshri is the biochemist. So they got together just 50 years later, and you see a very nice remembrance of them. And So we are ready now to walk to the Kotel on the first day it was open to the public after the Six-Day War. And I'd like to introduce you to my two children at that time, Dalit, who was 8 years old, and her brother Aaron, who was 6 years old, and you'll see them featured in the movie as we move along. So here again is the old city, and the green line is actually where we walked until we could enter the old city through the Zion Gate. And this is a picture looking over the old city. Many of you will have been there and will be able to pick out the Golden Dome. The Western Wall is right over here, where my cursor is right over here. And this, of course, is the Al-Aqsa Mosque, the third most holy site to Muslims in the world. And the Zion Gate is somewhere in here, That's where we went into the old city from there. And here you can see people walking, and you can see that it wasn't a big crowd at the time, but after everybody had assembled at the Kotel, it really became a very big crowd. But these are just actually normal, very normal people like ourselves, religious, non-religious. You can see the mixture as we move along through the slides. You'll see the different kinds of people that make up. But what we have here is the Domitian Abbey, which was actually Har Zion, Mount Zion, where King David's tomb is. And this was actually a small area that remained in Israeli territory. It remained Israeli territory for all those years between 1948 and 1967. So we could actually go to the Domitian Church, climb up fairly high up, and overlook the old city. It was really quite dramatic to do that. But it was like, you know, see, but don't touch. Nothing you could do. And here are several pictures, and I'd like you to get an impression of the types of people that are walking. You can see women, religious women, and all types of people gathered on that particular day. As I said, it was the first day it was open to the public in 1967. Here is Dalit. One of these stop on the way to the Zion Gate. See this very religious old man, see in Arabic and in English, no Hebrew. Of course, today, everything is in the three languages, Arabic, Hebrew, and English. And this is a very interesting sign, which says to the Western Wall, Le Kotel Maravi, and the sign down below, somebody's added to it, it said danger, which is very, was the whole story basically. And another picture, restricted area, taking pictures of forbidden. That was actually at the time of the thing. I think this is actually a picture of my then wife, just fitting into the picture. You'll see her a little bit later. And this was the scene that we saw once we, and here to the back, we see where the Western Wall is over here. And that's where we're going to go to. And you'll see what had happened in the meantime is the authorities had decided to clear a big plaza in front of the Western Wall to make it accessible to everybody. But that basically didn't come without a price. And here is a very interesting picture from 1929, picture in the Library of Congress, which shows a few Jews standing in the old city of Jerusalem, the Jewish the Jewish quarter, looking over what was then known as the Moroccan quarter. And you can see the Western Wall here, and we'll get much closer to it in a minute. And what actually the authorities did was, this was a fairly run-down area over here, the Moroccan quarter. They basically bulldozed the Moroccan quarter away. Lots of controversy about that. Something like 630 people were displaced as a result of this. So there really is as much as we were happy to have the Western Wall back with us, a certain price was paid for that. Get back to the Western Wall now, and you can see we're coming much closer to the wall. Very interestingly, there were a couple of palm trees. You see them here, you see one here. And the iconic picture of the Kotel that many, many of you know and have been there. This, of course, is the Golden Dome up here. And we're going to get much closer, and you can once again see the mixture of people that are making their way to the Kotel. Here we are again. Here's my son Iran in the front. I can't quite make out if Dalit is there as well, but she was. And we're making our way as close as possible to the wall as we can get. And just take a look and see once again the different types of people that were around at that time. Very, very interesting. Here, the Western Wall, actually in all its glory. As you can see, many, many people right up in front of the wall. And you can see the difference between this picture and the one that I showed you with a very narrow street that had existed for these or many years between 1948 and 1967. And here it has now become a plaza. And I want to point out one other thing So the wall that was built by the Turks, that's mainly this strata of the wall up here. These are from the Turks. You can see it. This is from an Arab period, the very top bricks. And the most lower kind of bricks are actually from the Herodian period, from the time of King Herod. They have a very distinct way that these rocks were cut and marked, and people could see them. Once again, just take your time and look at the different kinds of people that were there at the time. Here's another crowd scene, and you can see it's just made up of everybody. Somebody that's obviously not religious, but having a hat on his head. People who are not particularly religious, some people with kippot. And I think this, I'm not quite sure where the area that was designated at the time, where the area for women was. But as you can see, that's a very mixed crowd of people here, men and women mixing together without any problem at all. And a typical little chassid, a little boy with a run looking on at him. And once again, just let your eye cast over the different kinds of people that were there on that particular day. And here we come to an area of the wall that was obviously for prayers by more religious people. And not necessarily, there were some ultra-Orthodox there, but I think mainly modern Orthodox people in this area. And you can see little kids here and so forth, and parents showing their kids and telling them what really is going on and what they should be. And you can see up here, these boxes, the people had brought sort of presents for the wall, pushkas for the wall, and just piled them up here as they were. And here is this beautiful picture of the wall that I'm using as my background for the talk. And you can see all these mosses that are grown there. In fact, there are specific species of birds that live in this area too. And they've been looked at for many years. And once again, beautiful picture of a little Hasid boy with his father. And you can see behind him another Hasid and so forth. And this girl that looks, you know, quite... not necessarily religious. Once again, a picture of some of the religious people. And the palm tree, as I said, which was iconic for a few years, but after relatively few years, the palm trees were removed when they paved this plaza. And here is the family, my wife, Judy, my then wife, Judy, and Dalit and Iran on that day. Really just an amazing experience to have been there for that occasion. And the fact that I had come home only one day earlier from the army made it all the more special. And once we had finished being at the Kotel, we left and we found a tank, which had obviously had something to do with the conquest of Jerusalem at that time. And here we are on the tank, the three of us, and just me and Aaron on the tank. And here is a thank you from Dalit and Aaron's many, many years later. And thank you for letting us share our story with you. They're thanking you, the people that are watching. And there they are in the top corner again. And several years later in 2013, I had the opportunity to visit the Kotel again. And I said, why not have another picture to add to what we're showing? So there again, you have Dalit and Iran many, many years later, 1967 to 2013. Somebody can make the calculation. It's really quite amazing. And here's a picture of Dalit, Iran, Dalit, and their younger brother, Alon, who wasn't born in 1967. He was only born in 1969. So basically, that's all I wanted to show you. And thank you very much for bearing with me. And what I'll do, I'll stop the screen sharing right now. Come back to myself. And what I would like to do, just give me one second, because I want to show you the diaries. But in order to do that, I need to take away the background. So just give me one second. Okay, so here we are, just simply in my office. And here is the diary I'm just showing you now. You can see how small it actually is. Whoop, here we go. There it is. That's the diary, and if I open it up, you can see some of that terrible scrawl that I showed you. Quite interesting. And the book that was published is this book here, which is a diary of the Six-Day War. And it also included, I did have a much less fuller diary of the Yom Kippur War in 1973. And that's kind of as an addendum to this. But if you open up any of these pages, basically, let me see. Let me get back to here. Yeah, so what you will see on the one side, you'll see the actual writing in the diary, and then the transcription of that where my fingers are over here is what we read together. So it's really an actual diary, but only published in a few copies. So I have that here with me. So once again, thank you, everybody. Thank you for listening, and I'm happy to take questions.
May I ask a question? I understand that you were involved in all three conflicts, 1973, the Six-Day War, and also the First Lebanese War. Were you in the same unit, or were you assigned to a different unit in each of these three conflicts?
That's a very interesting question, Frank. So actually, in point of fact, it was the same unit. And although many of us are now in our 60s and 70s, and I'm probably the oldest of the group, we still maintain a very strong relationship between each other. We get together three or four times a year. I'm not in Israel to do that, but the group still gets together, and it was an organic group that stayed together for those three wars.
Thank you.
Well, Martin, I'm shocked. You didn't even tell me about all of this. What's going on? This is not fair. I should have been talking to you about this all along. It's a wonderful story. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Happy to talk more about it.
Yeah.
Martin?
Yes, Lynn.
Hi, I came in late. I wasn't able to, but I'll watch the recording. Hopefully it'll be online, and I'll catch up with everything. And thank you so much for all you did for Israel. Wow, amazing.
Well, tell us about your daughter's involvement in the Operation Solomon, since she's not here. Well, we're not privy to her story. Could you tell us a little bit about her story on her behalf?
Yeah, well, basically, when she finished the army, she was interested in social work. And so that's what she had been studying. And just about in 1991, the situation in Ethiopia became such that we were able to bring out from Ethiopia, in a matter of hours, 14,000 immigrants. And she was sent to Ethiopia to help organize the background to the transport. I mean, it obviously took a lot of work to be working with the Ethiopian community. Many of them had to be brought from quite far away to Addis Ababa. And then there was this short window when we could fly planes in, fill them to capacity. Seats were taken out of the planes, and the immigrants were sat on the floor of the plane to get as many in as possible. And they were flown to Israel. And she was actually on the last plane, or one of the last two planes, to come out on that day. And I remember we were actually in Jerusalem at that time, visiting 1991, I was there on a visit, and the planes flew over us. I was actually at Hadassah, and the planes flew over. It was just amazing because I knew that she was on one of those planes. I didn't know exactly which one. And of course, they came back, and their first task was to help settle the immigrants in absorption centers. They were taken to villages in areas around Jerusalem. And of course, you have to understand that these are people coming from another time zone in life. They didn't know what they had really very little experience of electricity and so forth. Toilets were totally foreign to them. So all of these elements had to be introduced to them in a very sympathetic and gentle way. And of course, there were elders in the community, older people, that had to be treated especially carefully, through to tiny, you know, to tiny babies. There were babies born at the camp in Addis Ababa that were then brought on the plane to Israel. So it was very dramatic all in all. And Dalit was there, as I said, from the time of organizing them in Addis Ababa, bringing them out in the flights, Mifza Shlomo, Solomon's, the Solomon event, and taking care of them. And that was the most difficult, but the most essential thing was taking care of them once they were in Israel and helping them to get used to this kind of life. And then eventually they were distributed to various towns in Israel, and they've become quite a vibrant community in Israel today, with actually a very interesting, fairly high percentage of the current younger people going to university, becoming lawyers, becoming doctors, and a very valuable contribution to society.
Did the first wave of Ethiopians who were brought out, I think from Sudan, in the operation, in Operation Moses, did they fare differently from the latter group, the Ethiopians who were brought out from Ethiopia in Operation Solomon? I understand the first group were housed in refugee resettlement camps for decades. Many of them never really left before they die.
Yeah, there were certain problems once they got to Israel. That took place in 1984. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure how many people here. I think we talked about it when we talked about Princeton Lyman.
Right.
Several months ago. So there was this movie made by Netflix called The Red Sea Diving Resort. And yes, that's basically a true story. Of course, it was, you know, it was sort of glamorized in the movie, but it tells the true story of how these Mossad operatives actually set up this camp and were able to bring out Ethiopians at night, put them into rubber zodiacs, and they were taken out to past territorial waters and were put onto an Israeli Navy ship and brought to Israel that way. That was one phase of them. The other phase is that Israeli Air Force actually managed to fly planes in to close to a big refugee camp in Sudan. And many of the Ethiopian Jews were put on these planes and brought over then. At that time, the absorption facilities were not as good as they were by the time of Mifza Shlomo, when Operation Solomon took place. So it took many, many years for Israelis to get used to this new type of person and for them to get used to us. So that was a more difficult aliyah, compounded by the fact that they had actually really had a very difficult time in getting from Ethiopia to Sudan, where they were then picked up or organized and picked up by, you know, picked up by either the boats or the planes, the operation organized by the Mossad. That was a terrible journey, and something like two or three, I would say about 2,000 people actually perished making that journey. It was a journey by foot from Ethiopia to Sudan, and very, very tragic stories took place. There is on Mount, not Mount Zion, but Mount Herzl, there's a wonderful memorial to these Ethiopians that fell. And I recommend to anybody that goes to Jerusalem not to miss making a visit to that memorial and getting a sense of how many people were actually involved in that.
I read a book on the British Mandate years, and in the early days of the Mandate, there was a riot at the wall because there were severe restrictions. The Muslims didn't want anything to appear to be a permanent facility. And someone brought some chairs and someone brought a Torah, and there was a riot, and people were hurt. So, and it was in that narrow alleyway that you showed the pictures of.
Right, that's exactly.
And the British military police were very strict about what the Jews could bring mm-hmm. they basically could bring a sitter, and that was it. Yeah. Nothing, mm-hmm. nothing that could look like establish an edifice or any kind of a thing.
Yeah, I'm sure that that's true. I don't know, you know, specifically stories, but there was a lot of trouble in Jerusalem between Arabs and Jews for many years. Excuse me a second. Of course, there were the riots in 1936.
Oh, yeah.
And certainly, you know, the Arabs didn't want any type of permanence to be exhibited there in that narrow street that you saw. And that's how it remained a narrow street for all those years.
Yeah.
Martin, coming back to 1967, if I may, I'm Steve Sabin. I don't think we've ever met. Okay. I was in Jerusalem in 1972, and we were on the Mount of Olives, and it was a small tour group, and the tour guide pointed out the Jewish headstones from a cemetery that was there, mm-hmm. that were turned into walkways and toilets by the Arabs during the occupation years, during the 19 years between 48 and 67. And then he pointed out a structure just beyond that, maybe 100 yards at the most, I think shorter, which was, he claimed, the international headquarters of the United Nations peacemakers, just to observe what was going on during those 19 years of dispute before it was liberated. And I don't know if I've ever encountered any stories about that beyond what I heard from the tour guide that day in 72. And since you were there at the time, do you have any insight to the UN observing all of these atrocities and doing nothing?
No, not really. I mean, obviously, I witnessed exactly what went on in the cemetery of the Mount of Olives, these desecrated graves and so forth, which, you know, took many, many years to restore. And in fact, there was a hotel right at the top of the Mount of Olives, which eventually was closed and access was not allowed to there anymore. But since there was an Arab population in Jerusalem, I mean, after the war, we talk about after the war, you know, we had to tread fairly carefully in order not to have riots or anything like that happen again. Of course, things did happen, you know, based on on what we call the Temple Mount, but the Dome of the Rock mosque was always a center of tension. Every Friday when there would be prayers there, it would somehow always end up in some kind of turmoil, some kind of resistance. And eventually, the government would stop them doing that, stop them for a few weeks when they promised they would be okay, let them go again. And this was going back and forth through all those years. But in 1972, which would be only 5 years after the war, many things had not yet been put in place. But I'm sorry, I don't really know about the UN observers. It's something that obviously we could try to look up and find more details.
I think I may have said 72, the year I was there, when I meant 67, the year of the war, because that's when this allegedly was being ignored by the United Nations. That's what I meant to ask.
So you were then 67?
No. I was getting what I said to you in my initial question. I was getting confused. It all occurred in 67. I saw it in 72.
Yeah, that's what I meant. Yeah, so you were there in 72. So, you know, that was not that many years later, and a lot still had not been put right yet.
Right. Thank you.
Martin?
Yes.
This is Sharon Kohani, and I wonder if you're familiar with a book called Red Sea Spies by Rafi Berg. My husband just read it. I mean, he just finished it. And he highly recommends it. I didn't know if you might be familiar with it and have an opinion about it.
I'm not familiar. Can you give me the name of the author again?
Sure. It's Rafi, R-A-F-F-I, Berg, B-E-R-G.
Okay. So that's not a name I'm familiar with, but it might be a more, so the one of the books that we have read is called... I've just forgotten it for a moment, but I think it's Mossad Exodus. And that's a story told by one of the Mossad operatives from his point of view. Very interesting. In fact, we have a book club here at the synagogue, and we actually invited him to talk to the book club. It's amazing what you can do over Zoom. I mean, he's in Tel Aviv and we're in Bethlehem, New Hampshire, and we have this guy telling these wonderful stories. But I would suspect that the book that you mentioned, if it's a new book, it may be just, you know, a more detailed sort of historical recounting of exactly what went on at the Red Sea Resort.
It did come out this year.
Okay, thank you very much. I'll take a look at that.
Certainly. Oh, good, thank you.
Thank you very much, Martin, for giving us such an interesting talk. I'm sure all of us will be visiting Yerushalayim next year because of the sort of talk. And definitely we'll look up your book. That's been most educational. One more question. During the three campaigns, what rank do you start and what rank do you retire in? Do you start as a private and end up as a brigadier general?
much more, what should I say? Yeah. Not really that way. I actually began, I guess, as a private. I think if I didn't even make sergeant by the time of the Third War. So that was basically it.
Well, thanks again. You're most welcome to join us, evening minion.
Thank you.
Thank you, Martin. That was
thank really you, Martin. Thank you.
Thank you.